the things that's happening this afternoon at 1 o'clock, if you, you may not know this, but there's an election coming up. and you may not know this, but there's some tension in the air about that election. So today at 1 o'clock, we've been invited to a prayer meeting at the courthouse square. I will have one of the topics. I was explained to yesterday is that we'll go to the four corners, and at each corner we'll pray for a different thing. The one thing will be peace and unity in our nation. One thing will be the coronavirus issue. One thing will be for wisdom. And one thing will be for financial hardships, based on all those other problems and situations in the world that people are having. I think I have, yeah, believe it or not, I think I have the wisdom part to pray for. So I'm not sure how parts were assigned, but, you know, whatever. So if you want to do that at 1 o'clock today, we're going to meet up there. They were very clear. The folks who were kind of leading the charge, Mark Hinton, I believe, from the Church of Christ, is the one who contacted me. So it's not about any one church or any one political slant. If you're blue or red, if you're a Biden supporter or a Trump fan, you're welcome and encouraged to attend. So 1 o'clock this afternoon at the courthouse. Based on Psalm 34, read with me, if you will, our call to worship. I will worship the Lord at all times.
God's praise will always be on my lips.
Glorify the Lord with me.
Let us lift our God's name together.
Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Blessed is the one who takes refuge in God.
The Lord redeems. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of our ancestors is our fortress. Amen. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for the privilege to gather in this place with these people. We pray for this gathering and for every gathering in our community, for the presence of your Holy Spirit to move and to speak. And we pray that we would all have open minds and open hearts, and we'd be receptive to the moving of your Holy Spirit right now. We thank you in advance for this opportunity to be with each other and to be with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our memory verse is there in the bulletin. Like I said, you also should have the refrigerator-ready copies. If somehow you got a bulletin and you don't have one of those and you want one, I know there's some more on the bulletin, in the bulletins on that back table. So feel free to grab those. Let's read that together first and then read the reference of where it comes from. I will praise God's name in song and glorify him with thanksgiving. Psalm 69:30. Amen. Thank you. Each week, when we come together, we do on purpose a set aside a time for a prayer of confession and reconciliation. And I think we say most every week that we're trying to build a habit. I think I have confessed to you before that when I walk to church on Sunday mornings, that is one of my best prayer times. That's a habit. That's what we're trying to build with this. If no other time, at least on Sunday mornings, I'll pause, I'll take a breath, I'll think about where I am, where my walk with God is, and where it could be. All right? Let's pray that together. Loving and gracious God, we confess to you and to our brothers and sisters that we don't spend enough time in your word. Forgive us for that failure. Remind us today that your word says we are fortunate to be your children, and we are also called to share our fortune with others. In Jesus' name we pray. And now we'll pause for a brief time of private, just between ourselves and God. Brothers and sisters, believe and share this most important of good news. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen. So this morning, Matthew chapter 5, verse 1 to 12. Let me say a little bit of background on this before we read it. Matthew chapter 4, now, you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all approach the life, the ministry of Jesus just a little bit different. So let's hone in on what Matthew does here. Matthew chapter 4 is the beginning of the public ministry, the public preaching ministry of Jesus Christ. So Matthew 5 through 7 is what is commonly referred to as the Sermon on the Mount. Now, the Sermon on the Mount is a collection of different teachings by Jesus. That's important for us to know because Matthew chapter 5, we're going to read in just a minute, the first few verses, contains the Beatitudes. And those are seen as the introduction to the Sermon on the Mount. Now, all three of those chapters, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, are important, heavy, important, vital teaching lessons from Jesus Christ. What we're going to read today is kind of the introduction to that. Some would say that Matthew places the Sermon on the Mount at the very beginning of Jesus' public ministry to emphasize the point that Jesus is the, capital T, capital H, capital E, Jesus is the teacher of God's people. Maybe my goal in all that is to emphasize the importance of Matthew chapter 5, the first 12 verses. Jesus wants us to know and he wants us to feel blessed. Jesus wants to remind us, to encourage us, to challenge us. Jesus wants it to be clear. You are blessed. Wants us to know that. Wants us to feel that in here. If this is the very first thing he says in his recorded preaching ministry for Matthew, it ought to be important, right? What do they say? You know, the first and last? This is the first. Matthew chapter 5, verse 1 to 12. Commonly called the Beatitudes. And when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. The disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." The word of God for the people of God, and your response is?
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Amen. So, a couple other questions. Why do you think it is so important that it's the first thing Jesus says when he says that we are blessed? We are blessed. How does Jesus begin and end this when he says? Let me find it again. Notice, he says in verse 3, "Blessed are the," this is the first one he says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And here's the last one he says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." That's how he begins, and that's how he ends the Beatitudes. Doesn't that tell us something about one of the biggest blessings, one of the most obvious blessings that we have? We are a part of the kingdom of heaven. Right? No matter if my spirit is down and beaten, no matter if I'm persecuted for my Christian faith, no matter if things aren't going like I want them to go, no matter if I don't have as much money in the bank as I wish I had, no matter if I didn't get the job I wish I got, whatever. We are a part of the kingdom of heaven. Everything else pales in comparison to that. Everything. I dare you to find anything that we've experienced in our lives that compares to that. We are God's children. We are connected to the creator and sustainer of all life. That's the beginning, and that's the end. Some said, as I researched for this morning, that all those verses in between are just a variation of struggles. All of those things they talk about after the first and the last beatitude, those are all struggles that we have. We mourn. We can't stand up for ourselves. We look for righteousness. Maybe in some of these readings, what he's talking about is people who are trying to live in the manner that Jesus teaches us to live, like showing mercy, being pure in heart, being a peacemaker. Those things don't go with the world, right? So Jesus says, when you struggle, when you're trying to live your life as I've called you to live, and things don't go like you want them to, let me remind you from the very beginning, the very first thing let me say to you, you are blessed. Because, as Allie pointed out, who never, ever, 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 ever gives up on us? God. Who never lets go of our hand? God. Who is with us every step of the way? God. Who strengthens and empowers and encourages and directs us forever? God. Jesus begins his preaching public ministry with that word. It might behoove us to begin our day with that word. We are blessed. We should remember that because of the joy that it brings, and also because that truth helps us through the difficult, struggling times we have. That's the first word that Jesus gives, according to Matthew. You are blessed. If you mourn, you have God's Spirit to give you comfort. If you struggle, you have God's Spirit to give you strength. If you're without, you have God's Spirit to provide. You are blessed with God's Holy Spirit. That doesn't mean things are perfect. That doesn't mean everything is exactly like you want it. But it means, again, God never, ever lets go of your hand. You are never alone. That's going to play for us just a few minutes.
And turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. And turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory. glory and grace.
We believe it's good practice for us to say out loud what we believe, a statement of our faith. We know that this does not include everything, but it's a good basic statement of what we hold near and dear to our hearts. If you will, join me in a statement of our faith. We believe that God is our Creator and that God loves us with an everlasting love. We believe that Jesus died for our sins and that Jesus rose victorious from the grave. We believe that the Holy Spirit gives us guidance and strength. We believe in the fellowship of God's people and in everlasting life that begins today. We believe that we're called to proclaim the love of God to the world. Amen. There are some prayer concerns listed on the back of your bulletin. Please remember to pray for our elected officials, our citizens, our country, our first responders, our schools, fires out west, and the hurricanes down south. You may or may not have heard that Stephanie Stroud's husband passed away on Friday, Lee. If you would remember to pray for Stephanie and her family. Maybe you know, maybe you don't. Lee is Catholic faith, so we won't be doing the service there or anything, but certainly pray for Stephanie and her. I'm not sure if they're her children or just Lee's children. I think she said to me Lee's, but they're working on the service and making plans for that. But if you remember to pray for them, that would be much appreciated. Appreciate your prayers again for Carla and her family and all of us at Craig's funeral was on Friday. And it was a good service, a good time with family as much as that can be. So I'll lead us in some prayer and then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer together, okay? Let's pray. God, we thank you for your presence in our lives every day. We pray for the private things, the decisions we have to make, the struggles that we have. We ask for your hand and for your presence and for your help. Remind us that we're blessed with your presence and that we're never alone. We pray, God, for our elected officials, for us as citizens, for our country. We pray, God, for wisdom, for your presence. We pray, God, for our first responders, for all of those who so diligently have been struggling with the COVID, those who deal with it every day in hospitals and doctor's offices, for our law enforcement and for our fire personnel and for ambulance folks. We pray, God, for nurses and care centers and nurses' aides who do some of the most hands-on kind of work with folks who are ill. We pray, God, for our schools, for our teachers, administration, and staff. Pray for our children. We pray for their safety. We pray for wisdom for them as they make decisions. We pray for those who are suffering from all the fires out west and those who suffer from the hurricanes down south. We pray, God, for your presence and for all of us to do what we can whenever the opportunity arises for people who are suffering. We pray for Stephanie's family with the passing of Lee. We pray for Craig's family with his passing. We pray for Hines' sister-in-law who's dealing with cancer. And we pray, God, for your hand and for your presence in all these situations. We pray for each of us this week that we might be encouraged by the truth of the gospel, that we are blessed as your children. We thank you, God, for Jesus, for all that he does, and we pray as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We haven't been standing recently, but today, let's do that. Let's stand together. We'll read together our benediction, and then I will I'll do that in the back. Come on. Let's pray together.
Let us be aware of all the blessings that surround us. Let us recognize all that God has given us. Let us be inspired to pass our good fortune on to others. And let us give thanks to our Father in heaven by going forth praising God's name.